Welcome to Dentum 360, another day of quick and easy concept-based learning. In my last lecture, we familiarized ourselves with some important terms and structures that were involved in the development of tooth, like what is ectoderm, ectomesenchyme, what is dental lamina, vestibular lamina, etc. For those who haven't checked it out yet, please find the link in my description below. In this lecture, we'll continue with the development of tooth and we'll be discussing various stages of the tooth development and in detail the various stages. Now, tooth development is a very continuous process, but because to understand it better, we have divided it into three stages. And those three stages are divided based on the shape of the enamel organ in every stage. So in the bud stage, the enamel organ looks like a bud, and later as it grows, it looks like a cap in the cap stage and bell in the shape of a bell in the bell stage. First, we'll be discussing about the bud stage here. So please look at this diagram here. This is a diagram of the bud stage. Here we can appreciate some structures, like this is the oral ectoderm from which the dental lamina is proliferating, and the dental lamina is giving rise to the enamel organ here. As you can see the shape of the enamel organ, it is like a small bud. And here you can see the ectomesenchyme, which is present below the enamel organ. Now, let us see the enamel organ in detail. Here, enamel organ is lined peripherally by low columnar cells, and in the center, enamel organ contains polygonal cells. So in blue color, what you are seeing are the polygonal cells, and peripherally you see low columnar cells. These cells are connected with each other through desmosomes. Okay, and for those who don't know what are desmosomes, they are nothing but intercellular connections between the two cells. So any epithelial cell in the body will be connected with each other through desmosomes. So let me write it here. Desmosomes are nothing but intercellular junctions. So each cell in the enamel organ are connected with each other through desmosomes. Whereas the peripheral cells are connected with the basement membrane. This black line that you are seeing is the basement membrane, which separates the enamel organ from the underlying ectomesenchyme. And the peripheral cells of the enamel organ are attached to the basement membrane through some structures which are called as hemidesmosomes. As the name is suggesting, it is the half of desmosome, because only one cell is involved here, and that is connected to the basement membrane. So cell to basement membrane conjunction is the hemidesmosomes. Now coming to the underlying ectomesenchyme. If you appreciate here, I have drawn some dotted structures in two colors. All this is ectomesenchyme only, and while there is rapid mitotic activity going on in the enamel organ cells, at the same time, even the ectomesenchymal cells multiply very rapidly, and some of the cells, they condense around the enamel organ like this. Can you see it in green color? That is dental papilla. Okay, so this condensed ectomesenchyme just below the enamel organ is the dental papilla. This dental papilla serves as a primordium to form dentine and pulp. Here in the red structure, the red dots that you appreciate, this is the condensed ectomesenchyme which surrounds both the enamel organ and the dental papilla. This is called as the dental follicle or the dental sac. And this serves as a primordium for the supporting structures of the tooth, which involves cementum, periodontal ligament, bone and all. Okay. So this is the bud stage. Right. Now, coming to the cap stage, as the tooth germ continue to proliferate, there is rapid growth taking place in the enamel organ. But this rapid growth is not uniform. So, in the previous segment we have seen bud stage. Now, if this growth occurred uniform like this in every direction, we would have seen a very large spear like thing. But is the tooth, does the tooth look like this? No. Instead, only unequal growth takes place. That is, growth takes place only in this direction and not everywhere. So, this unequal growth leads to the shape of a cap that you can see in the picture on your right hand side. So, appreciate this picture please. This is a picture of a cap stage. Now, whatever drawings I'm making here, you can, this is a very easy line diagrams and you can draw exactly the same in your exams. It is very easy rather than seeing your textbook diagrams. Okay. This is the oral ectoderm and this is the dental lamina. And here from the dental lamina, we can see the enamel organ. Now, the shape of the enamel organ has changed. From a bud, it has become a cap. Now, see this shallow invagination you can see here at the bottom part of the enamel organ. So, the excess growth has taken place at this places. Okay. Also, the cells of the enamel organ have also changed. The peripheral low columnar cells that we saw in the bud stage have now differentiated into tall columnar cells and they line this concavity of the cap. So this is now called as the inner enamel epithelium, right? Why is it called as inner enamel epithelium? Because they lie on the inner side of the enamel organ. Similarly, the cells here on the convex surface of the enamel organ are low cuboidal cells and they are called as the outer enamel epithelium for the same reason that they lie on the outer side of the enamel organ. Now, do you remember what were the cells seen in the center on the bud stage? Very good. They were the central polygonal cells. But here you are seeing some network like thing, right? So what happens here is, inside the enamel organ, there is lot of glycosaminoglycans present. Glycosaminoglycans are present excessively inside the enamel organ. So, as a result of osmosis, you know that always the fluid flows from a high concentration to low concentration. So, the water from the surrounding ectomesenchyme is drawn inside the enamel organ. As a result of which, the cells are pushed far apart, but still they are connected to each other with cell processes. So, because of this, the cells assume a network-like structure or shape. And that is the reason they are called as stellate reticulum. Stellate means star shape and reticulum is network. So you can see, because of the processes, they appear as star shape and a net or meshwork like structure. The tissues in the enamel organ are named depending on two things. Either they are named depending on the location or they are named depending on the structure or the shape of the tissue. So here you can see that inner enamel epithelium and outer enamel epithelium are named depending on the location, whereas stellate reticulum is named depending on the shape. So again, as we have seen in the bud stage, the epithelial cells are attached to each other with the help of desmosomes. So the outer enamel epithelium is attached to the stellate reticulum. Inner enamel epithelium is attached to the stellate reticulum and cells of each other through desmosomes. Similarly, the cells of the inner and outer enamel epithelium are attached to the basement membrane with the help of hemidesmosomes. Very good. I think this is simple and very clear. Coming to the ectomesenchyme. So here I have retained the color of the diagram or the structure, that is green color is dental papilla and the red color is dental follicle. So don't get confused. So here the condensation of the ectomesenchyme just beneath the cap, that is the invagination of the cap, is called as the dental papilla. And here there is one difference that you see, some red colored dots I have made here. Now this is, please don't get confused, this are small dots, these red color bigger dots are the active budding capillaries that are seen. So because the enamel organ is growing, even the nutrition that it needs is growing. So the nutrition, as I said in my previous class, nutrition is provided by the ectomesenchyme. So because of the need, even the ectomesenchyme shows budding capillaries. Okay. Now coming to the dental sac. So dental sac is nothing but the condensed ectomesenchyme which is present around the enamel organ and the dental papilla. So here you can see some fibers. So some delicate fibers are beginning to form here to form a capsular structure which surrounds the enamel organ like this, or the tooth germ, sorry, the entire tooth germ. So this is pretty much about the cap stage. Now this, coming to the functions of each structure, inner enamel epithelium are going to become the future ameloblasts. These tall columnar cells are going to differentiate into future ameloblasts. And what are ameloblasts forming? They form the enamel. Whereas the stellate reticulum like tissue, the stellate reticulum, it acts as a shock absorber. Okay, it acts as a shock absorber and protects the enamel forming cells. These cells are very delicate and they need the protection from any trauma during the, you know, pregnancy when a mother. So this stellate reticulum protects the delicate ameloblast. Coming to the dental papilla. Dental papilla forms the future dentine and pulp. Whereas the dental follicle forms the remaining structures, that is cementum, bone and periodontal ligament. Now there is an easy way to remember all the derivatives from these structure. The importance of these structures that we see in the cap stage. The inner enamel epithelial cells are later going to differentiate into tall columnar cells which are called as ameloblasts, and they are going to form the enamel. This stellate reticulum will act as a shock absorber and will protect the delicate enamel forming cells. So this tooth germ is forming when? In the embryo stage, right? When the mother is pregnant. So at that point, if there is any trauma to these cells, that is prevented by the stellate reticulum. Whereas this dental papilla is going to form your future dentine and pulp, and the other supporting structures of the tooth, that is the cementum, alveolar bone and the periodontal ligament, is formed by the dental follicle or the dental sac. Now if you see the figure on my left side, this is just a simple tooth with the different parts. Now I'll give you an easy way to remember what is derived from what. Okay, so enamel organ, in the name itself it is present, it's going to form the enamel. So this white part is the enamel and it is formed from the enamel organ. Coming to the blue part, this is nothing but the dentine, and this red color, red shaded area, is the pulp. Dentine and pulp is formed from the dental papilla. So you can remember it like DNP. Dental papilla is DNP. So it forms DNP, that is dentine and pulp, right? So DP forms DNP, dental papilla forms dentine and pulp. And all the remaining structures, that whatever you can think about in a tooth, is formed by the dental follicle or sac. So okay, so that is your cementum, here the white part, these periodontal fibers, the bone, everything is formed by the dental follicle or the sac. Clear? I think this might help you to remember the derivatives of each structure here. In the next segment, we will see what are the transient structures or temporary structures that you see in cap stage. This is again a very important short answer. So let us see that. Coming to the temporary or transient structures, these structures are seen in CAP stage and they are called as temporary structures because they disappear just before enamel formation begins. So why are they present and what are they? So let me answer my latter question first, that is, what are they? They are four structures that we see in the enamel organ of CAP stage: enamel knot, enamel cord, enamel septum and enamel navel. Now, what is enamel knot? As you can see here, the cells here in the enamel organ, they are densely packed. So all these dense dotted structures that you see are nothing but cells only. And the cells of the enamel organ here are densely packed and they invaginate into the underlying dental papilla and form a small conical or a knob-like structure. So this is called as enamel knot. So this small knob-like structure which consists of densely packed cells are called as enamel knot. Knot means, you know, what is a knot? Like, okay. So, because it is so densely packed, it is called as enamel knot. When the same knot continues upwards into the enamel organ, it is called as enamel cord. And when this enamel cord extends completely to meet the outer enamel epithelium, then you can see it divides the enamel organ into two different parts. So at that stage it is called as enamel septum. And where it meets the outer enamel epithelium, it forms a small depression like thing which is called as enamel navel. Navel because it resembles the umbilicus that we see in a human body. It appears as a depression here. So these four structures are called as temporary structures and they are seen in CAP stage. Now let me answer my first question, that is, why are they present? So experiments have proved that enamel knot acts as a reservoir for dividing cells. Because it consists of densely packed cells, it acts as a reservoir of cells because the enamel organ is continuously dividing here at this point. It is very active. So enamel knot acts as a reservoir of cells. The second function of enamel knot is that it acts as a signaling center and many growth factors are expressed here which later helps in determining the shape of the tooth. Okay. One of the important growth factor which is expressed by the cells of enamel knot is fibroblastic growth factor, FGF8. Okay. So, the two functions are, it acts as a reservoir of cells for the actively dividing enamel organ and it acts as a signaling center, and many growth factors are expressed by the cells of the enamel knot which helps in the in determining the shape of the tooth. Correct? So, this is the temporary or transient structures of CAP stage. Having completed bud stage and CAP stage, let us move on to more advanced stages, that is bell stage and advanced bell stage. Please don't get scared by looking at a complex diagram here. We will go one by one. So, let us see the diagram on my left side. This is the bell stage. So if you see, the shape of the enamel organ here has assumed the shape of a bell. And there are a lot of different structures that we see which weren't visible in the CAP stage. So let us see the enamel organ. Now, the enamel organ here shows four different tissues. In CAP stage, we were seeing only three different tissues, whereas in bell stage, four different tissues can be appreciated. Now, here I will be repeating a lot of things that I have already told in CAP stage because, as I have told previously also, the tooth development is a continuous process and everything is in a continuum. That is why a lot of points will get repeated. Starting from the inner enamel epithelial cells. So, this is the inner enamel epithelial cells which line the concavity of the bell. Okay. This surface of the bell is also called as the aboral surface. okay, and it is lined by tall columnar cells, and the nuclei, as you can see, is present away from the basement membrane, and this is called the inner enamel epithelial cells. Now at this stage you can call inner enamel epithelial cells as pre-amyloblastic layer, because this is just before the inner enamel epithelial cells differentiate into amyloblast. Next structure that we see here is stratum intermedium. It is present between the inner enamel epithelial cells and stellate reticulum. Now this is one new tissue that we are appreciating in Bell stage, and we haven't seen in Budd and Cap stage. So stratum intermedium is nothing but a two or three layers of flat squamous cells, which are present just above the inner enamel epithelial cells. The function of this tissue is to actively participate in enamel formation. Now some experiments show that they definitely have a role to play in enamel formation. What exactly the role is not very clear. So just you can remember that stratum intermedium helps in enamel formation. Next tissue that we appreciate here is the stellate reticulum here. Stellate reticulum. Again, as we have discussed previously, stellate reticulum is named depending on the morphological shape of the tissue, because it appears star-shaped and it has a lot of intercellular substance present in between the cells. These intercellular substance consist of glycosaminoglycans and albumin, which gives it a cushion-like consistency, and hence it acts as a shock absorber and protects the amyloblast. Next tissue is the outer enamel epithelium. This outer enamel epithelium lines the convexity of the bell, and also called as the oral surface. So inner enamel epithelium was lining the aboral surface of the bell, whereas the outer enamel epithelium lines the oral surface of the bell. So here you can see these are cuboidal cells, low cuboidal cells, which form the outer enamel epithelium. Now coming to the dental papilla, here you can see the cells which are closer to the inner enamel epithelium have differentiated into tall columnar cells. So these are nothing but the odontoblast cells. Odontoblasts are the cells which are going to form dentine. So just this is the stage just before the hard tissue formation begins. So that is why we can see the cells in their differentiated form. Coming to the outer enamel epithelium, the outer enamel epithelium shows more of fibers, and the fibers are arranged in a circular fashion so as to form a capsule around the tooth germ. And at the same time, a lot of budding capillaries are seen, this time in the dental sac. If you remember, in the cap stage, the budding capillaries were more in the dental papilla, because dental papilla was closer to the enamel organ. Now there is going to be reversal of nutrition. What is that? We will see in just the next few minutes. So here we see active budding capillaries in the dental sac or the dental follicle. So this is the bell stage. Now there are some changes which occur in the outer enamel epithelium just before the enamel formation starts. Changes in the outer enamel epithelium. These changes are important, and why do they occur? That also we are going to discuss. So first let us see what are the changes that occur. The outer enamel epithelium, the shape is normally cuboidal cell. They become irregular in shape. And the basement membrane, which is present, on which the outer enamel epithelium rests, that becomes wavy. Basement membrane becomes irregular and wavy. And the third thing that we see is a lot of budding capillaries are seen near to the outer enamel epithelium. Active budding capillaries are seen. near to the outer enamel epithelium. So all these changes you can appreciate on the picture on the left side, on the right side. If you appreciate here, please see this outer enamel epithelium. Can you see the shape? It has become irregular. As well as the basement membrane, can you see? It is so clean and straight here, whereas here it has become wavy and irregular. And whatever loops are formed, in all those loops you can see blood vessels here. Okay, so after having discussed the changes in the outer enamel epithelium, let us see why these changes occur. See, now here if you see this dentine and this is the enamel, so at some part near the cusp tip the hard tissue formation has started. So dentine has been deposited, enamel has been deposited. Now previously enamel organ was getting its blood supply from dental papilla, right? Now because of this hard tissue here, the nutrition and the blood supply from the dental papilla has been cut off. So what is the other way by which enamel organ has to get its blood supply, because still enamel organ has work to do. So then it shifts its nutrition from dental papilla to dental sac. That is why in order to obtain blood supply and nutrition from the dental sac, these changes in the outer enamel epithelium occur. Understood? So this is the changes that occur in the outer enamel epithelium. Now, just before enamel formation, there are also two other changes which occur in the enamel, in the outer enamel epithelium. This occurs just before enamel formation. First thing is, microvilli develop. Small microvilli, they develop near the blood vessels. So, suppose if I draw here, this is the basement membrane. These are the outer enamel epithelial cells. Small microvilli will develop here. And this microvilli, and this is the blood vessel. Why this microvilli develops is, it helps in increased absorption of the nutrients. So, at this time, please remember that the tooth germ is very, very active, because enamel is forming, dentine is forming, a lot of different metabolic activities are going on. So they require a lot of nutrition. That is why the cells change themselves to obtain maximum nutrition and blood supply that they can. So here also, development of microvilli is one of those changes. Second is, you see lot of matrix vesicles. Lot of matrix vesicles are seen in the cells, and also mitochondria. Why? Because again these cells are involved in rapid transport of nutrients. So that is why they require more energy. And as we know, mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. So they see more, you see more of these mitochondria also. So these are the changes which occur in the outer enamel epithelium. So having discussed the Bell stage, so what happens here? Let us see other two important structures which is present in the Bell stage. First is this part. This is called as cervical loop. It is called as cervical loop. Now, this structure is very, very important, and it is the most active site in the tooth germ, because this continues to remain active even after the enamel and dentine formation is over. So this cervical loop is the place where the outer enamel epithelium meets the inner enamel epithelium, and from here only the root formation will develop. That we will see when we see the root formation. But because the root formation initiates from this cervical loop, that is why it continues to remain active even after the hard tissue formation is over. So that is one again important structure in Bell stage. The next here you can see successional lamina. So this is the dental lamina, and as we have seen in our first lecture, how the successional lamina comes. So please, I hope you remember, how is the successional lamina coming? It is nothing but the lingual extension of the dental lamina. So here, lingual extension of the dental lamina gives a successional lamina, and this is nothing but the bud stage. So already a successor of the primary teeth, that is a permanent teeth, is in the bud stage here. So see, can you see how simultaneously and how methodologically all these processes occur in the body? Okay, everything has their own time. So this is about bell stage. Now, so here till here we have seen about the enamel and dentine formation, how they have started. A little more into that we will see. Before continuing further, let me explain one thing and be clear about it. See, because as I am telling it from the start that tooth development is a continuous process, and only for our better understanding it has been divided into different stages. So there will be a lot of times where things will overlap. Okay, so don't get confused. There is no such thing that I can say, okay, till here is the bell stage, from here advanced bell stage starts. Okay, there is no such thing like that. So whatever I say, some parts will be that the previous figure that of the bell stage that I was explaining. So some of the features you see there, then I have drawn again, that also comes in bell stage only, but then you see some other features there. So it happens in a continuous process like thing. It's not like different it's not like you can, you know, distinctively say that okay, this particular thing happens in bell, this particular thing happens in cap stage or something like that. Okay, so be clear about that. Now continuing with advanced bell stage only, so here we know that the hard tissue formation has already started in the bell stage, correct? In hard tissue formation also, there are two things that happen. The first thing is the organic matrix is laid down, and the second part is the mineralization of that organic matrix. So the organic matrix formation part occurs in the bell stage, whereas in advanced bell stage, the mineralization occurs. So the mineralization of the organic matrix occurs in advanced bell stage. Okay. How does it occur also is important. Always first dentine forms and then enamel forms. That I hope everyone knows. So if dentine also forms, it doesn't form randomly somewhere. It always starts at the cusp tip and then from there it goes downwards. So suppose we are talking about a molar here. So molar has two cusp tips like this. So dentine formation starts here. So some of the dentine is laid at the cusp tip here and the other cusp tip here. And wherever the dentine is laid, on top of that enamel is laid now. Enamel forms here. So as the enamel forms, the dentine formation again continues downwards. So dentine formation continues downwards here and here, here and here. So same thing, enamel follows it. Enamel follows it. So ultimately you will get a crown shape like this. Dentine and enamel. One more very important structure occurs or forms in advanced bell stage, that is dentino-enamel junction. Because dentine and enamel is formed, so the junction between both of them is the dentino-enamel junction. And why do we need to specify this? Because it is important. It acts as a blueprint for the tooth, for the shape of the tooth. So we can say that the shape of the tooth is determined by the DEJ or the dentino-enamel junction. So dentino-enamel junction determines the shape of the tooth. Now, can someone tell me, just few minutes back we have also discussed one more structure which was involved in determining the shape of the tooth. What was that? Very good, I hope all of you have answered this. It is enamel knot, right? What was enamel knot? It was a temporary structure that we saw in cap stage. So if you have answered that, it means that you have followed me till now. So we have pretty much completed all the stages of root development. Now then, in the next lecture, I will be covering the root formation. Correct? So till then, if you like my video, please like, share and comment. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Okay? All the best. Thank you.